Muchísimas gracias por la invitación. Esta información que vamos a compartir tiene el propósito de comunicar una manera de hacer, de hacernos arquitectos, de hacerse arquitectura desde lo local.
So I said, thank you so much for having me and you know, to talk about exploration of architecture and the local.
Yo hago parte de Convite, una cooperativa de arquitectura, donde somos más o menos 15 profesionales, entre arquitectos, politólogos, ingenieros administradores, ingenieros financieros, profesionales sociales, que tratamos de desarrollar una coreografía interdisciplinar para hacer arquitectura y urbanismo.
So we're a cooperative of about 15 architects, planners, thinkers, administrators, who are, I forget the last bit, yeah, translating via Zoom is challenging, who are developing a new approach to working with people in the city in the built environment.
Somos una cooperativa de arquitectura porque lo que nos interesa es juntar la diversidad que compone todo nuestro territorio. Estamos ubicados en Colombia y pues Colombia tiene unas características de paisaje, de biodiversidad muy amplias que lo que hacen es que hay una complejidad muy grande a la hora de hacer procesos creativos.
We're a cooperative of architects who are interested in engaging with the full diversity of our homeland, Colombia, and inspiring our creativity through this diversity.
Y eso lo que hace es que los procesos de arquitectura exijan que siempre sean un diálogo para combinar saberes ancestrales, saberes populares, también conocimientos técnicos, arquitectónicos. Entonces casi siempre estamos deconstruyendo o desaprendiendo y aprendiendo muchas cosas, ¿cierto? Hibridando y haciendo.
So we're a practice that is entirely based on a cooperative practice, entirely based on dialogue. Dialogue that looks at indigenous, local, vernacular, organic knowledges and understandings. And so we are a practice focused on learning, on deconstructing and on reconstructing and relearning together with the people with whom we work. So in cooperation with the people with which we work as part of the practice.
En este momento estamos viviendo una crisis social muy grande donde se está repensando la representatividad de los jóvenes, de las minorías ante el sistema democrático que representa hoy el poder pues, político, pero también estamos en una crisis de biodiversidad ecológica y de medio ambiente que nos tiene completamente activos y tejiendo de otras maneras y tratando de colonizar muchas ideas que hoy nos tienen en esa crisis.
So today, Colombians are in a very serious political crisis, a crisis of democracy. Many of you probably have seen a lot of the activism happening, but we're also in an ecological crisis of biodiversity. So, you know, all these respective crises call for an economization or a kind of an understanding of the means and limits through which one can operate to address the various crises in some way or work between the cracks.
Nosotros estamos ubicados en Medellín, que Medellín es la capital de Antioquia y como ciudad, pues tenemos un fenómeno, creo que muy común en Latinoamérica y es que somos más rurales que urbanos. El 70% de Medellín es rural, el 30% es urbano. Pero toda la atención y toda la planeación y todo el interés está sobre el urbano nomás.
So the practice is based in Medellín, which is actually within kind of, if one thinks of the greater extent of the city, primarily rural, right? So we see the kind of crisis of democracy and the crisis of ecology kind of colliding. And yet all the talk is on the urban and a very particular imagination of the urban, which they're kind of challenging.
Eso es un poco de los paisajes que tiene la ciudad de Medellín. Pues se le dice la capital de la montaña. Es una ciudad que tiene una topografía muy agreste, entonces la autoconstrucción y las comunidades han autogestionado el desarrollo del urbanismo y del paisaje urbano, pero también tenemos una ciudad planeada y diseñada por los arquitectos que se juntan y que generan un paisaje muy diverso y hay veces muy contrastante, pero lo interesante también es ver cómo dentro de la misma ciudad tenemos también un páramo, que es el páramo más pequeño de Colombia. Entonces, con estas imágenes queremos mostrar también como la complejidad a la hora de desarrollar ejercicios de planeación.
Just to give a sense of the diversity of landscapes within the city, which combine nature, various forms of formal planning, auto-constructed or self-built cities. ¿Qué es un páramo?
Como el donde nace el agua.
A kind of springs. A complicated diversity of city that expands out of the planned and into the natural, and the threshold isn't quite clear. So again, explaining why they work across the various crises of democracy and ecology.
Bueno, la ciudad en los últimos 20 años de urbanismo ha cambiado por completo el imaginario. Digamos que Medellín tiene una capacidad muy grande para ser la mejor del mundo en todo. Pasó de ser la más violenta del mundo y tener un imaginario de violencia y narcotráfico a ser la más educada y luego la más innovadora. Por eso es muy importante entender esa relación de la arquitectura y el urbanismo con el ejercicio político, porque en esta pequeña historia del urbanismo contemporáneo de Medellín es que nosotros nacimos parte de eso.
So the political history of Medellín is a very complicated one, but it's one of extremes, one of always framed as the world's most of something, whether it's the world's most violent city, particularly in the 80s, 70s, 80s, early 90s, or the world's most kind of experimental development city. So Medellín, famous for all kinds of architectural interventions, cable cars, works in informal areas. So architecture in both senses is central, whether Medellín is framed as the most violent city or the most kind of innovative city. It's formative for the identity of one from Medellín, the architect.
Hoy lastimosamente estamos viviendo también una crisis dentro de la ciudad porque los procesos sociales y la disposición política que hay hoy está poniendo en evidencia lo frágil que ha sido este último urbanismo de los últimos 20 años.
So there's a momentum in the present that is witnessing the fragility of these extremes, right? So they're kind of coming together, right? So it's no longer, Medellín is no longer the city of kind of best practice case study of experiments. It's no longer the world's most violent. It's somehow a collision of these worlds in the current moment.
Esto se representa en las imágenes que vemos de los proyectos donde entre el 2004 y 2007 empieza el urbanismo social y se empieza a ejecutar y a producir todo el espacio público y equipamientos, y casi que los últimos 8 años lo único que hemos vivido es de renders. Entonces hemos dejado de construir, hemos dejado como de construir a estar muy visionarios y solo haciendo propuestas de renders.
In the early 2000s, 2002, 2004, 2007, 2010, Medellín really is famous for urbanismo social, social urbanism, with really a huge amount of investment in urban infrastructure and architecture, with architects really at the forefront of this. And since then, Medellin has gone from a city of really genuine experimentation and investment and faith in architecture to a city of renders of architecture, so renderings, so a politics of renderings has dominated fantasies of what the future could be. Mal, can you put my video on so I can also like signal when to pause the
if you possible. Put your video on.
Oh, I don't see myself. Oh, anyway. Okay.
Con este contexto, pues la posición de la cooperativa es reflexionar sobre el deber ser y el hacer de la arquitectura en nuestra ciudad y en nuestro país, y decolonizar esos imaginarios hegemónicos con los que uno sale de la universidad o del pregrado.
So this is the context of Coinvite, of the context in which Panaris is working in the cooperative that he's helped to shape, which is about somehow my screen left, where'd it go? About shifting, observing hegemonic imaginary practices or imaginations of what the city should look like that become common sense or appear to be common sense, and trying to shift them through the activity of a cooperative, of an architecture cooperative.
Entonces, pues ese paso para imaginarnos una práctica cooperativista, unos arquitectos que les interesa entender la participación y la planeación de base en ese intercambio de saberes entre lo técnico y lo popular, y ya no nos interesa solo construir edificios, sino poder diseñar procesos para la producción del espacio.
So this means, as a cooperative of architects, there is an intimate dialogue and circularity between technical knowledge and popular everyday knowledge, right? And challenging common sense and hegemonic and servicing other narratives that aren't maybe the ones recognized by official people. So, I think so. That's central to the practice, is a dialogue and cooperation.
Dejar de diseñar ciudades como formas limpias o muy cerradas, a diseñar más procesos creativos de participación.
Right, a focus not on buildings necessarily or, you know, completed clean master plans, but on designing processes and the formation of processes.
También dejar de producir imágenes de marketing o los renders como en un ideal homogéneo, y pasar más al collage, al recorte y a la visión heterogénea que nos identifica como ciudad tropical.
So to move away from renders and idealized visions and to move closer to collage heterogeneity of the tropical city.
Y terminar no solo de pensar en detalles constructivos industrializados, sino poder recorrer todos nuestros territorios para identificar detalles constructivos no industrializados, o sea, de inteligencia colectiva.
And to build collective intelligence, to move away from a very specific model or kind of overplayed model of construction, of industrialized construction, and to find a new collective approaches to building that maybe move away from certain mass-produced consumerist industrial processes.
Establecer esta posición crítica sobre la arquitectura y la profesión, y nos permite establecer nuevas relaciones con el capital. Nos permite también representar la diversidad y la biodiversidad y construir un imaginario tropical desde lo local, cierto, conectándolo a las discusiones globales.
So it's the practice starts out from a critical position, which inherently involves having to reconsider your relationship to capital or to finance, right? The architectural profession is so, of course, linked to funding of projects. So rethinking the relationship to finance towards imagining an indigenous tropical city, and of course, at the same time, considering global connections at once.
Lo que nos interesa dentro de nuestro ejercicio profesional es entender que la calle hace parte también de esa formación y tiene casi que el mismo peso que la universidad.
We believe that, you know, a part of this is the street has as much weight as the university in our learning process.
Este primer proyecto hace parte de la periferia. Este primer proyecto es un centro comunitario autogestionado, autoconstruido en la periferia de la ciudad, donde está el borde urbano-rural, o sea que está ahí, pero la ciudad institucional y formal no reconoce este asentamiento comunitario.
So this first project is a community center, community hub that is self-built, self-managed, at the threshold between the urban and the rural, where the city does not recognize the city. So the official city is not, does not recognize this as city. So in the space that would be technically considered illegal, an illegal settlement.
Esto es un poquito el paisaje de lo que se ve en el barrio El Faro. Como pueden ver, es un barrio de autoconstrucción, de economía progresiva y tiene bastante naturaleza.
So this is the neighborhood El Faro, which as you can see is a neighborhood that's been self-built, auto-constructed. It's a neighborhood of a certain kind of gradual economic development or self-built economic development of embedded economics rooted in the community.
En la foto aquí, ustedes ven mi cursor. En este lugar es donde se ubica el proyecto del centro comunitario, que antes era una capilla que un sacerdote fundó, pero de repente un día el sacerdote no volvió al barrio y se convirtió en el centro comunitario.
So this that mouse was where it was the site, and it was formerly a chapel founded by some priest who left and was abandoned, and then it kind of started converting itself into a community center.
A nosotros nos invitan a los barrios cuando van a hacer convites. Convite es el término que usan las comunidades para convocar a los vecinos y construir carreteras, casas, viaductos, por medio de una fiesta donde hay comida y hay herramientas y todos ponen un poco de lo que saben hacer.
So the community invited the cooperative Coinvite when they were going to do a Coinvite, which is what Panris's cooperative is named after. A Coinvite in Medellin in Colombia is a way to build things by having a big party, right? So the community will have a big party, the people in charge will get a bunch of food, music, cook a bunch of stuff. And that way, they'll get all the people that can help out to build in exchange for a big party and food. And it's kind of the way that auto-constructed developments are built, settlements are built all over Medellin, but not only homes, also in all kinds of infrastructure, viaducts, bridges, water, electricity hookups, are all built through parties, basically. The name, which is Coinvite, the namesake of Panaris's practice. And this is when they invited them to come help out.
Entonces, ya la comunidad sabe participar y está organizada y nos invitan a nosotros como arquitectos a ser parte de esa comunidad, donde nosotros ponemos nuestros conocimientos como diseñadores. Entonces, hacemos talleres para explicar conceptos geométricos, conceptos estructurales, pero no solo eso, sino que invitamos ingenieros estructurales, invitamos todos los técnicos que necesitamos para poder desarrollar un proyecto con todas las normativas y con todo lo que sabemos hacer para que sea seguro y para que sea sostenible.
So the community already has the capacity, manpower and ability to build space and they might have, but they sought out Coinvite because of the recognition for the kind of technical assistance that comes from listening and working in dialogue that they've built. So, you know, they come in, provide certain technical assistance in terms of engineering questions, structural questions, but also environmental and sustainability questions.
En la parte izquierda era lo que existía, la capilla que existía, y en la parte derecha son los collages y las imágenes de cómo va a quedar el proyecto.
So on the left is the chapel, on the right is, you know, the kind of the images of how the it will look when it's built. Of course, you know, the means are very, very limited, so everything is funded from there and comes from there.
Aquí en la ciudad tenemos una institución que se llama la curaduría, que es la que da los permisos de construcción, y siempre que se va a iniciar la construcción de un edificio se pone un cartel amarillo donde se explica se explica técnicamente qué es lo que se va a hacer. Lo que hicimos en el barrio es que cuando empezamos a construir hicimos un cartel amarillo explicando el proyecto con la firma del barrio completo, como en la soberanía pues legítima de lo que estamos haciendo.
So in Medellín, when one builds a construction, a formal, let's say, city-approved construction, there is a kind of yellow sign one puts up, signaling what's about to be built and the formal approval. So they mimicked this process and made the same sign in a neighborhood that, where there is, of course, no formal recognition or the site. They've reproduced the exact sign with the signatures of everyone who lives there, designating, you know, that this is official on their behalf. Kind of, for them, it's official.
Eso es como un hackeo a las formas tradicionales de hacer ciudad, y lo que nos permitió hacer ese primer gesto fue que pudiéramos establecer relaciones con la empresa privada y con un montón de donaciones de la ciudad para poder hacer real este proyecto. Casi el barrio puso, la comunidad puso y la ciudad completa también puso para poder construir.
So this is a kind of a hack, because even though the project is technically illegal, the site is unrecognized, by simulating the formal process and making that sign and demonstrating that there was kind of unanimous support or near unanimous support, they were able actually to seek to generate funds from various private organizations, and I guess I think even partly from the city. So actually somehow in pretending to be the law, they've actually managed to legitimate the process, a kind of hack.
Este ya es el proceso ya de construcción, material local que es la guadua, ladrillo que es el mismo con el que ellos saben usar, con los que construyen las casas, pero lo que hicimos fue desarrollar unos detalles constructivos donde se ponía también como en proceso creativo su mismo saber. Si el ladrillo se pone de otra manera, ¿qué pasa? Entonces, los maestros de obra y los líderes comunitarios, pues, también se dejaron influenciar por esas ganas como de hacer cosas diferentes y empezaron a jugar, y pudimos desarrollar este calado o disponer los materiales de otra manera, con el mismo saber de ellos.
So he's walking us through the process of designing and detailing and constructing and showing it's really a dialogue, right? So as the plans come, then from as Convite produces the plans following workshops and conversations, and as the local master builders start building, you know, all kinds of joints will be resolved in particular ways that the community is most, or that the builders are most familiar with, or forms of bricklaying will happen. So these are kind of accidents, but not accidents. They're built into the process, right? This is the process, right? Is allowing an openness that then manifests in the way that people want to manifest.
Así es como va, todavía está en proceso, es un proceso lento, pero ya tiene techo. Y lo bonito de este proyecto es que no solo somos diseñadores, sino que producimos toda la experiencia espacial, tanto de hacerlo y también de vivirlo, de habitarlo y de empezar a gestionar la cotidianidad que va a pasar en él.
So, going back to the idea of process, that Coinvite Cooperative sees itself as process designers as much, if not more, than as physical object designers. That, you know, it's a very slow process in this case, right? It's a very, very, very challenging circumstance to build in, totally unrecognized formally, slowly recognized in some ways. But the very process itself constitutes the community that will become a part of the space, right? So certain relationships are formed that then will then become or are already the community space, the community that will run it.
De hecho, los arquitectos, las personas que ven ahí, son dos arquitectos de la cooperativa que fueron los que hicieron los collages y parte de los planos del proyecto haciendo, ¿sí?
Here are two members of the cooperative who are working on the site.
Este segundo proyecto es de una escala mucho más amplia de urbanismo en un barrio que hace parte del centro de Medellín, que el centro de Medellín es un río, el río Medellín, y este es un asentamiento también informal que se produjo a partir de los desplazamientos de los 90, de los desplazamientos violentos de los 90, y la gente llegó a habitar esa ribera del río, en la parte norte.
So the second project is at a much bigger scale. It's the scale of an urbanization or almost town planning. And it happens in this neighborhood here, El Sinai, which is on the main river that runs through Medellin. Medellin is a valley that surrounds this single river. And it's, you know, what would be called informal settlement or irregular, unrecognized, self-built settlement produced in the 1990s by the displacements that resulted from, that were the result of civil war and violence in rural parts of Colombia.
Este es el barrio, es un barrio que tiene callecitas de 1.20, de 1.50 hasta de 2 metros, pero también tiene de 5 metros. Pues tiene una diversidad de circulaciones y de encuentros que hay veces son caóticas, pero también hacen parte de la identidad cultural de nuestra cotidianidad.
So this is just to give you a sense of this. This is images from the site to give you a sense. It's streets will vary from 1.20 meters width, 1.50 meters width, which is the most common width of a street, to 5 meters. A feeling that can sometimes be chaotic, but this certainly gives a sense of the identity that the community can, the space in which the community forms its identity.
Y lo estructuran muchas quebradas, mucha agua y muchos corredores verdes con mucha vegetación. Entonces es una combinación entre la autoconstrucción y la naturaleza.
It's a site with lots of green, a tropical site of water, of nature, and that's been somehow built into the self-construction. So it's not, contrary to the dominant narrative, it's not just only destroying what exists, although there is, of course, damage. It's also working with and around nature. And this is an aspect of interest to families.
Esto fue un concurso internacional que nos ganamos, que invitaba a pensarse los 29,000 metros cuadrados, cómo podría ser el futuro de este barrio, en una etiqueta que es renovación urbana.
This is a competition that they won about how to kind of rethink the strategy, the urban strategy around this. I can't remember the dimension he gave, but this dimension on the site.
Entonces, lo que hicimos fue meternos al barrio, a conversar con la comunidad y a reconocer todos esos hábitos e inteligencias colectivas, detalles constructivos no industrializados y procesos de organización social y económico propios del barrio para imaginarnos todo un esquema mucho más lento de renovación urbana.
This began the very, very, once winning, the very, very slow and gradual process of building understanding of the embedded economic relations, the social relations of the site, the forms of knowledge and practices that give the site its character, right? It's a very gradual learning process.
pero también empezar a construir imaginarios donde la medida del cuerpo humano no es el que rige solo la visión del urbanismo, sino empezar a implementar las medidas de los insectos, de toda la biodiversidad, de los niños, de los perros callejeros, para tener una visión más biodiversa del urbanismo y que cada uno de los elementos que se diseñen le respondan a poder albergar toda esta vida.
So, you know, in the process, understanding the city not only to the scale of an adult human, but also children, even street dogs, but also insects and all the biodiversity that is part of this site.
La propuesta se llamó Barrio Manigua. Manigua es como se le dice popularmente a toda la naturaleza que crece de manera espontánea, sin ningún plan, sino que en Medellín y en Colombia casi que en cada rincón que pueda haber un poquito de tierra, crece plantas y crece una cantidad de vida.
So they've called it Barrio Manigua. Manigua, I think, if I'm not mistaken, a word that means a kind of total biodiversity abundance, right? The kind of fullness of what we think of when we think of tropical abundance. And that's become the name of the site.
Entonces, más que definir una forma urbana, una morfología, definimos un proceso cooperativo para que los vecinos se organizaran en cooperativas de vivienda y poder empezar a englobar el suelo e ir gestionando pequeños edificios para ir liberando espacio de los que ya estaban ocupados.
So the primary strategy, the foundational strategy, is looking at land management and land ownership and looking at ways in which a cooperative structure can be formed to address land management questions, right? So how one can actually bring pieces of land together, which has been divided over decades, but also how to think of the cooperative administration management of land.
Más bien en un sentido como de mejoramiento integral de barrio, aumentando las capacidades de densidad, que imaginarse un borrón y cuenta nueva de la renovación urbana.
So in doing so, you know, augmenting density actually, or thinking about how to do density well, rather than of course destroying and rebuilding, which is so common the strategy of master plans in the city.
Implementar también estrategias de autoconstrucción. La autoconstrucción hace parte de nuestra identidad arquitectónica, de nuestras tradiciones culturales. Y esto nos empezaba a dar como unas arquitecturas de 5 pisos que mantenían la escala de la comunidad. Y este ya es como el imaginario, donde pues, se desarrollan unos edificios, pero no para que sean bonitos, sino para que enmarquen la vida y la dejen ser. Entonces, que pueda aparecer el graffiti, que pueda aparecer la ropa extendida, que puedan aparecer la cantidad de musgos y de vida, tanto de las personas como de los microorganismos, ¿cierto? Y de la humedad.
Perdóname, es que no, perdió un poco de lo que estabas diciendo. ¿Se puede repetir otra vez?
Este es el resultado ya,
imaginario. This is the proposed result, the imaginary result of Miracuadora. The proposed result where the proposal is, it totally involves auto-construction, so self-building in its design, right? So how to design with, for self-construction, right? But in such a way that it still is recognized as legitimate and that ecology is incorporated.
If I could just add something, he just mentioned about designing around or designing for the possibility of cables to dry clothes or the sort of situations that are common in these sort of neighborhoods that are often ignored when these master plans or any interventions are designed or added to it.
Y este tercer proyecto, que es la arquitectura y el urbanismo como agenda colectiva y comunitaria. Este barrio es en el barrio Moravia. El barrio Moravia hoy es uno de los barrios que está en peligro de extinción por la visión de renovación urbana.
So here is a project of about urban recognition and urban sort of branding or reframing. This takes place in a neighborhood called Moravia, which is on the verge of extinction, of kind of implicit forced eviction. Andrés, puede ser tenemos que ir un poquito más rapidito dale, porque ya estamos a 10 minutos y todo el mundo se dale va a lograr. Gracias.
El barrio Moravia hace parte del centro de Medellín, del centro que también se renovó en el urbanismo social. Es un barrio que se ha construido a partir de convites, tanto para construir sus casas, como para construir las calles y para construir sus centros comunitarios.
So, Moravia takes place also in the center of Medellín. It's a self-built settlement, completely self-built settlement through coinvites, through these parties, gradually since really the 70s, but really the 80s and 90s.
Donde las señoras, las amas de casa y las doñas han sido las lideresas que han representado esa capacidad colectiva y casi que son la memoria y también son el futuro del barrio.
It is a neighborhood particularly known for the kind of powerful role of women as organizers, builders, all the main generational organizers of Moravia have been very, you know, powerful and prominent women from the community.
Moravia es muy famosa porque antes era el basurero municipal, donde se desarrolló una montaña de basura que luego convertimos en un parque y que hoy seguimos tratando de gestionar.
Moravia is particularly famous because it's built on top of a garbage dump, which is the hill you see in the top left. Okay, so formerly it was the municipal garbage dump. Community invaded it, filled, covered the garbage dump, or kind of planted green on it, and then took over.
Y hoy estos son los planes que tiene la ciudad para Moravia, es convertir este barrio que pueden ver en estas imágenes llenos de vida a estos que parece ser más un negocio inmobiliario que el derecho a la ciudad.
So these are the image you see here is what the city would like Moravia to become, right? This is the plan for Moravia. They want to buy up, evict, demolish, and reconstruct in that way.
A nosotros nos invitaron para desarrollar actividades y reconstruir el relato de resistencia, o sea, hacer parte de la comunidad para empezar a hacer proyectos espaciales y empezar a decirle a la ciudad que no era justo tener una visión de renovación urbana en un barrio como este.
So the Moravia Community Group, especially a group of lawyers called Moravia Resistance, women lawyers from the site, invited Coinvite to organize, let's say, the strategy vision for the resistance.
Y pensarnos el urbanismo del barrio para la ciudad y no de la ciudad para el barrio.
To think of an urbanism of the neighborhood for the city, not of the city for the neighborhood.
Empezamos a hacer asambleas con todos los colectivos de Moravia y en un ejercicio creativo construimos unos carteles para dar esos mensajes que le daban significado al proceso cómo se ha construido el barrio.
So this began a long process. So again, it's about process more than design of community workshops, and then a visual identity campaign of posters, of signs, communicating the outcomes of those workshops. It was then plastered all over Medellín, all over Moravia in particular, and all over Medellín.
Se desarrolló una colección casi de 25 carteles que los repartimos a la alcaldía y también los pegamos por todo el barrio y a todos los políticos y a la empresa privada para que tuvieran un mensaje amoroso de Moravia y que tuvieran un poco más de sentido común.
So, you know, this is a campaign that they called, they invented a kind of marketing campaign for the resistance called Amoravia, Love Moravia, about dignity and kind of certain statements that came out of workshops from people about what it means to be live in a dignified space. So building awareness of the campaign to demolish Moravia and people's kind of resistance to it.
Luego desarrollamos unos dispositivos con guadua y con materiales locales para decorar las fachadas y hacer que las calles se vieran un poco más y cogerle más sentido de pertenencia a los hogares que hoy están tratando de comprar desde la alcaldía.
So the initiated the city is the municipality is slowly buying up properties from people, and so they initiated a campaign of micro interventions that anyone can do, sort of signal properties that might not be entirely in agreement with the slow kind of nearly compulsory purchase of the city by the town.
Esta agenda se ha expandido a participaciones también con otras universidades como UCL, ¿cierto? Para hacer el reconocimiento de patrimonio vivo, que son workshops. Y hoy estamos en un proyecto que tenemos el propósito es de volver a contar esas historias de Moravia a partir de ese urbanismo solidario.
So various alliances with other organizations and campaigns, but now they're in a process of building a kind of oral history of Moravia as part of a solidarity campaign, as part of the urban strategy. So building the oral histories into the site.
En esa revisión histórica de cómo se ha construido el barrio, nos hemos encontrado múltiples metodologías autogestionadas de la comunidad que ha permitido negociar entre ellos y negociar con el Estado.
Which means recovering and retelling and reinventing the history of how Moravia was built, recontrolling the narrative in a common sense. And in the process, discovering or kind of documenting all kinds of really, really extraordinary autochthonous or vernacular modes of negotiating shared forms of construction.
Es un barrio donde las casas que existen hoy, la gente las pagó con tiempo de trabajo construyendo las calles del barrio, y lo que hicieron es negociar con la alcaldía para cambiar tiempo por el equivalente a las escrituras de la casa.
So what came out of this retelling of the narrative of the construction of Moravia is the documentation of an entire parallel economy, a non-monetary economy, an economy of time. Of people sharing each other's time to help build things, to defend properties, but then rigorously having an accounting of that time, which is still transacted today for all kinds of different things. So the whole, the whole town operates with a parallel economy, a time-based economy that is used to transact for goods, but also construction and security.
Esto lo llamaban bonos de ayuda mutua.
Called mutual aid bonds. They named them themselves bonds of mutual aid.
Y ahora pues seguimos trabajando sobre encontrar esas metodologías y hacer esas traducciones técnicas también para ponerlas como contrapropuestas a las propuestas dogmáticas de urbanismo que borran y que quieren todo nuevo.
So now the project of Coinvite involves kind of working within this parallel economy of mutual aid bonds and framing this as the condition of possibility for an architectural intervention that somehow serves to block the compulsory eviction of the site.
Y bueno, seguimos en el proceso de experimentación, tratando de aprender a volver a lo esencial de la arquitectura y el urbanismo, que es representar la vida.
So you know, it's a process of going back to the essential of what architecture and urbanism is, can be, and how it represents the life of the people who inhabit it.
Muchísimas gracias.
Gracias, Pandris. So, no oyes el clapping porque los otros no tienen micrófonos. Estamos todos nosotros con micrófonos. Pero seguro que hay muchos que están hablando. You know, I think we have 7 minutes left. So it might be a bit tight for me. I was going to show...
We can stay.
Iwet was saying that we can stay for a bit longer, if that's okay with Van Ries and you, of course.
Okay, well then I'll do a really quick run through a couple of slides. I think
Van Ries, ¿está bien si nos quedamos de la hora?
Ah, claro, perdóname. Sorry.
Muchísimas gracias por la charla. Muy interesante todo.
And then gracias. We'll have some time for Q&A.
Can you see that?
Yes.
So, okay, so I'm just gonna like blast through some things. I'll try to do something. I think I put too many slides. I'll just blast through. So Panelis and I met as part of this project, Peak Urban, which is a grant I'm a member of, which is a collaboration between these institutions. And I'm just to give you some background and context. Then doing fieldwork in Medellin, I became familiar with his work in Moravia, which is an area I'm researching and investigating. Here's an image just so you see it again. It was before it was occupied, here it is now. And Moravia is particularly known both again in this kind of language of extremes, which Medellin is known as a city of violence and death and catastrophe with repeated fires that have burned down the construction on the former garbage dump, but also of this kind of social urbanism, which framed so much of how we think of Medellin in the 90s, the cable cars with kind of very aesthetic streetscape interventions by architects, which actually did have a profound effect and served to build a lot of community solidarity, which still exists today, and which Panarese is kind of actively working with. Here's a cultural center built by a famous, wonderful Colombian architect, Rogelio Salmona, which is central to all the initiatives. It's where Panarese holds all his workshops as he builds the resistance marketing campaign against eviction. Again, here's the plan for the city, which has this in mind with some emojis from an image that was circulated between various activists in Moravia, right? So this is, we go from, you know, this and an extremely organized and solid and organized and rooted understanding of a neighborhood and a community to the point where there's this a parallel economy based on mutual aid bonds to this understanding of how the city should become, right? Now, how is it doing that? How is the city gonna do that? It's doing that because everyone currently doesn't have actual private ownership rights to their own land, but they're slowly giving people titles to their individual land so that they can slowly buy them up one by one at the price that the city decides. Very, very, very low for extremely central and viable real estate. Just down here are some of the biggest, most popular kind of urban developments of Medellin, just next door. So here you see more or less Moravia in yellow. There are four distinct quarters named after, you know, various communities from different parts of Colombia that moved there in the 70s, 80s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s. And here you see the part that has already been bought up by the city one by one, right? So the process is the city gives a title, an individual title, and then buys it up very quickly for more money than the resident has probably ever seen, but certainly way below the actual value of the property, as low as one third of the value of the property, okay? At the same time, the community is aware of this, right? And is trying to force a kind of collective action against a kind of defection, right? Because of course, if one is very, very poor and one sees a certain amount of money, quickly this could be transformative for one's life. And so they're trying to present a case to the community that it's not worth selling out, that we can create something else, okay? Central to this are women organizers, in particular, the Hernandez family, three generations of which are central to what's called now called Moravia Resiste, here graffitied on the bottom, which is what Panarese is organizing a solidarity, or let's say a marketing campaign for. Moravia Resiste has mobilized the legacy of architectural intervention, often a very cosmetic architectural intervention on the site to their advantage, using these spaces for actual structural transformation or proposing structural legal transformation. So whereas a lot of the spaces appear to be kind of symbolic architectural interventions, beautifying a slum, actually they're now manifesting in the way that Panarese has described as spaces of processes of structural transformation, of allowing the kind of organic common sense of a community to take an institutional power, okay? Here is the latest Hernandez, Luzmila's daughter, not Luzmila's, who has formed a kind of awareness of in a discourse around what englobe and desenglobe mean. Englobe means a communal, a shared ownership of land, de facto, because it's not recognized by the state, versus a desenglobe, a parceling out into single owner divisions of land in the way that we have, for example, here. Okay, now this is the dominant approach. What the city's doing is a dominant approach to urban development worldwide, right? One of the key prongs of the World Bank, of the UN, is to give people titles to their land under the argument that if they do so, people will be able to get loans and self-build, right? This is the argument of this gentleman down here, Hernando de Soto, which still shapes, you know, one of the main prongs of the World Bank and UN Urban Planning Policy Today. And yet we see what the effects of that are, right? The ability to slowly piecemeal buy up because people are really likely to defect from the common good when they see, when they're in such a precarious situation and they see a possibility to make a small improvement in their lives. Now, this is now happening at an accelerated stealth pace in Medellin. Medellin is the case study for the first tech company seeking to, by app, kind of Uberize the privatization of your land. Okay, this is where I start to meet Padres. I came to Medellin interested in how this kind of Uber for land titling is working. Okay, Suyo is an app that is funded by Pierre Omidyar, the founder of eBay, to streamline through collective claims the privatization of land. Again, under the kind of benevolent impression that this will actually improve people's lives. And it certainly does improve some. But all the evidence shows over and over and over again is that when you bring in land privatization campaigns into many, many informal settlements, people tend to defect. They tend to sell. They tend to see immediate short-term gain against long-term, against potential huge long-term benefit. And they set up a new settlement somewhere else. So I'm arguing that this is basically happening, that we're going to have a kind of new global enclosures movement, potentially, in the way that it happened here, as we export a really a 17th century, 19th century property model from Britain to the world, effectively a decidedly post-colonial process, right, at the expense of all kinds of other ways of understanding our relationships to land all over the world. So as you saw in the example of Padres, people have developed their own understanding of what it means to own and transact land that both has a vocabulary for forms of collective ownership and transacts on collective ownership through sharing of time rather than cash. Okay, so how do we understand that? And then how do we, working in the tradition of Panris, figure out ways of translating that into systems that legal regimes might recognize? Okay, so this is the question that I brought to Panris and we've started to working on together. Now, immediately one thinks of community land trusts, which is a kind of alternative that one sees in some places around the world to the single owner kind of privatization model. A community land trust is when you separate ownership of land from ownership of houses. People retain the ownership of their individual house, but land is collectivized. So if there are 100 houses, you own your house and 1% of the land, which is in a trust, rather than the land immediately below. What that does is it means it makes it much harder for someone like the government of Medellin to buy it up. Why? Because to sell your share, you need the consent of everyone else who owns a piece of the trust. Whereas if you just own the land, you can just sell overnight, ignore your neighbors and run. Okay, so it forces a kind of deliberation and slows down the process, a kind of entanglement. So we started thinking, you know, could a community land trust work on this site? How would we make it work with in a bespoke way where it maybe is no longer even recognizable as a community land trust with, let's say, the organic political economy and modes of exchange and understanding ownership that actually exist, documented, studied in very, very close detail by Coinvite. So here we see the kind of partnership that we're setting up. And I'm just going to really blast through it now because you all know that I can talk for too long if I'm not careful. Coinvite at the center, which is, eminently experienced and trained, let's say, collaborator and framer of processes as an architectural mode of thinking and acting that may involve construction or may not, in cooperation with Murabia Resiste, which actually is the center, right? The tradition of legal activists from the site who are interested in englobar, of not parceling the land, finding new ways to bring it together, right? And actually a tech startup. So let me explain why. First of all, when I say englobar, the people are not interested in having a single communal ownership of land. That is not the fantasy. People still understand the benefit of being able to sell their homes, but they want some way to still be able to slow down the little nibbly purchasing of the city with the vision to make it just a bunch of towers. Okay, so what is this tech company doing here? Well, in Colombia, you have actually all kinds of laws that through a juridical archaeology, I've started to analyze and bring up against the Moravia case study. So you have the law of horizontal property, which is a law that exists for all these condominiums built around Medellin, highly securitized towers built in the 90s in responses to the violences of Colombia, particularly Medellin, that are actually effectively forms of semi-private, semi-shared ownership. Copropiedad.co is an app designed by some really nice people in Bogota that helps with the collective management of the resources and all the complexities that come with mixed, shared, private, what is going on here? Mixed shared shared and private ownership. Okay, so I've gotten involved. I said, what if we set up a condominium in Moravia. What do we think of Moravia as a kind of condominium? But totally rethink the idea of condominium, right? In a way that works with mutual aid bonds, a system of mutual aid bonds. And so this is the kind of scope of what we're doing. It's a bit paused with COVID. But we started doing workshops to try to see where, let's say, condominium as a kind of hack or disguise or mimesis of systems institutionally recognized by the state with legal precedents can be brought together in some way with the existing, let's say, unrecognized political economy of mutual aid in a way that benefits people. And at the very least, lets people exchange on their land at actual market value. At the very least, they don't get ripped off, okay? So, you know, just some examples of diagramming of how we've been thinking of forms of meshed ownership. You know, a community land trust implies bringing together all the land in a neighborhood, but why couldn't it be two neighbors only? Is that enough to slow it down? Why can it be one tower only? Why can it be a couple apartments in that tower? What would it mean to share ownership over floor plates and walls, but not the space inside the house, right? How can we be much more creative and experimental with how we think of what this division is in a way that makes sense with what people have on site? So, you know, one of the ideas that crossed is an idea that, you know, you own 10% of your neighbor's house and they own 10% of yours. So in order to sell the whole thing, you need consent from four different people. That wasn't what people wanted. But that's, you know, some of the ways we've developed kind of proposals out of the thinking. And here are just some sketches with Padres, with the community of how to come up with bespoke property arrangements for the bonos de ayuda mutuo, mutual aid bonds. Of course, me, kind of social theorist, loves it when you hear mutual aid. I teach a lot of you guys Kropotkin in second year. So immediately invoking a whole legacy of embedded economic practices that work perhaps in parallel here quite legitimately and effectively and functionally to the state, okay? So I'm not gonna talk about this because it's just a way starting to develop mechanisms of negotiating with the state to create new land transactions that allowed an institutionalization of different modes of mixed private shared ownership. And here the precedent is the detached condominium, which there's a legal precedent for in all kinds of gated communities in Colombia. And here are the drawings of the kind of discourse of the process, right? So it's a very long process that's been frozen. Moravia has experienced huge problems in COVID. All kinds, of course, the impact on poor communities has been particularly severe. We might not have access to all kinds of things that are necessary in a pandemic, but also it's also become an opportunity for a new generation of land invaders to kind of complicate the existing community solidarity. So a whole new generation has come to the site. But we've developed a kind of long-term strategy to build this discourse, right? And we're just at the beginning of that, right? Designing bespoke property frameworks that understand and are tailored to bonds of mutual aid, but are recognizable by the city as a condominium, as a luxury condominium effectively, right? Or that hack those laws in a way. And just as a quick statement, you know, why is this decolonizing land? Well, first of all, the idea that a single owner and a single family should own a single plot of land to the center of the earth, to the sky, is really an invention of 17th century Britain that's been exported to the whole world. And it need not be so. Right? Perhaps people would like it to be so, and they should have it if they want it, but also, why is that the only option, right? This is the premise. What other possibilities are there? How can we think outside of the hegemonic idea that that is the only mode that we can exist in relation to land? The land must be a highly commodified and exchangeable commodity. Certainly, we exist within an economy that requires some kind of forms of transaction and trade, but need it be totally commodifiable as if it were, you know, a computer or a cell phone, okay? So, this is decolonizing, I think, in relation to the lectures of last week and previous weeks, because land is at the center of how we think of what the home is. So the single family home, with this kind of idea of a nuclear family that kind of comes out of the 50s in a way, exists because of this relationship to land, right? The suburbs, the gated community, in this particularly normative way, highly gendered, highly racialized way, exists because of a particular relationship to land. So rethinking land is also a condition of possibility for rethinking not only the home, but the family, the feminist city, to rethinking all kinds of forms of abolitionism or rethinking what it means to be secure or safe of policing, let's say, or alternatives to policing of community jurisdiction or control over security in a site. So the implications I think are tremendous, right? So when you get to the very root of it, land to me at least, maybe it's because I'm obsessed with it, is at the heart of so much injustice in the world. It's just a few degrees away, okay? So this involves new ways of thinking across disciplines and new methodologies. But in particular, we're positing an architectural social science, a speculative social science that not only asks, you know, what, how, why, and how to avoid catastrophic climate change, how to avoid all kinds of problems, but what if? And therefore, we introduce a new question. How for? How could conditions X need to be arranged for Y possible scenario to be realizable? Okay, so the question we posit is how for, a new question. And that's it. You know, how do we bring it up? We've got partnerships with UN Habitat to potentially scale it up, a memorandum of understanding. We're interested in new forms of documenting, new forms of ownership and value around the built environment. And we've got relationships to the city. And indeed, Suyo themselves have expressed an interest, the app, the kind of Uber privatization and rethinking beyond the hyper-individualized form of model of ownership that they currently advocate and streamline. There's also links to all kinds of bigger issues, from abolition to climate change, to circular economies, to COVID-19 mutual aid structures elsewhere. And we're gonna have a big workshop where Panelis is coming to Cambridge. I don't know when, it's been postponed twice now. But we're bringing together architects, lawyers, and tech practitioners with a core group of ethnographers and social scientists to really ask how for, right? To bring the empirical qualitative research together with the speculative, the three different languages of the speculative, the architectural, the legal, and the technical. So that's it. Sorry for going over and for being super fast. Happy to talk to anyone again or who'd like to know more. So I think that wraps it up.
Thank you very much. Well, as I said in the chat, people are very welcome to write any questions either in the chat box or in the Q&A. I have prepared a question for Panris, if that's okay. Maybe while people, if they have questions, write in the chat. Panris, yo quería preguntarte cómo haces para hacer que una iniciativa como Convite sea económicamente sustentable. O sea, tú hablas de diseñar, por ejemplo, cosas en un contexto de fiesta, en un contexto de solidaridad, pero asumo que el proceso de diseño, de el tiempo que te toma planearla, o sea, financiarlo, todo eso debe tomar una parte muy grande de tu vida. Y cuando regresas a la ciudad, a tu casa, tienes que pagar renta, comprar un montón de cosas. Should I translate the question now? Yeah. So the question is how to make an initiative like Convite economically sustainable. I asked him about... he mentioned designing these things in the context of parties and urban solidarity, and how when he goes back home, he has to pay rent and go grocery shopping and all these things that would at some point make this theme, at least in my understanding, like difficult to achieve or contradicting. Yeah, Panris.
El ejercicio, nosotros tenemos, vivimos el día casi en 70-30. 70% hacemos un ejercicio comercial donde tenemos clientes y atendemos las necesidades de los amigos y de los que pueden pagar un arquitecto normalmente. Y el otro 30 lo dedicamos a poder desarrollar estos proyectos comunitarios. Cuando alguien nos contrata a nosotros, un porcentaje pequeño de esa inversión de contratarnos a nosotros se va para subsidiar estos proyectos comunitarios, para ir entrando. Pero cuando las comunidades nos invitan, nosotros lo que hacemos es que les hacemos todo el plan de trabajo y le decimos cuánta plata es que tenemos que conseguir. Y dentro de esa plata, pues están también los honorarios de los arquitectos, de los ingenieros, de todo lo que se necesita. Okay. Obviamente con unos precios, pues, mucho no comerciales, pero pues que dan para poder sustentar unas horas de un ingeniero y eso. Y ahí el compromiso con la comunidad es que entre los dos tenemos que conseguir la plata para poder construir, para poder pagar técnicos, para todo, ¿cierto?
Interesante. Nick, do you want to
translate? No, that's all you.
So Panris mentioned that His firm works in a 70-30 dynamic, in the sense that 70% of his practice revolves around commercial architecture and dealing with sort of conventional design requests. And part of that, a part of the money that this normal project invests in Vandris's firm, a part of that money, small part of that money, goes to subsidizing the other 30%, which is about this Convite initiative. He also mentioned, if I'm not wrong, that there is a mutual agreement of both the community that invites, the communities that invite Convite to design something for them, in the sense of Patrice's firm would give them an estimate of the amount of money that is needed to build the intervention, and it is the responsibility of both the firm and the community to work for that funding. Yeah.
Fantastic.
If
you have any other questions, please put them. Write them on the chat or the Q&A. I'm happy to ask if one of you could translate. So thank you, Vandris and Nick, for these fantastic presentations. And I have one question to each of you. So Vandris, when you presented the first project, you said that the community invited you to contribute and help them with the design. Was this the first project that you engaged with in this manner? And if so, why did they approach you? Any other reflections on starting such to work in relation to such initiatives? We'll end here.
So en el primer proyecto, ¿cómo es que la comunidad te conocí? Te buscó, o sea, ¿cómo creaste ese aeropuerto, el diálogo, o sea, del principio, ese aeropuerto con la comunidad? O sea, ¿cómo te buscaran? ¿Cómo sabían de Coinvite?
Porque casi que los sábados y los domingos los dedicamos a caminar por todos los barrios y a participar de los convites. Nosotros llegamos al barrio porque estaban construyendo como unos techos y entonces nos invitaron pues para ir a ponernos las botas y a pegar ladrillo y a comer de la comida. Y cuando llegamos nos dimos cuenta como de la realidad, como de la capacidad que tenía la comunidad y ahí empezamos a trabajar juntos, ¿sí? Como que, hey, hagamos el centro comunitario, hágale, hagamos el centro comunitario. Miremos esta cancha que tenemos por acá, también la podemos mejorar. Y hemos ido construyendo una agenda donde ya nos invitan. Y por referencia de esa comunidad, pues nos referencian a otra comunidad. Entonces, como el voz a voz se va regando de los arquitectos que les gusta ir a los barrios a construir, que pasan bueno siendo obreros.
Yeah, basically, word of mouth in a way. They were going to a bunch of other Coinvites, understanding the process, that word had gotten around that they were there and that they were understand the process. Then they invited them to a Coinvite, kind of parties, dinner, a lot of parties. I should add, and Panis doesn't say this, but he's very, very socially active in other realms as well. So he does a lot of community organizing and all kinds of and work in local politics and all kinds of domains. So he's a really, really effective kind of communicator with all kinds of. So explicando que también es muy activo en otros lugares, en otras maneras de activismo, de organización, que organiza las comunidades, y seguro que eso también ayuda.
Sí. O sea, vamos a todas las fiestas que nos invitan.
He goes to all the parties he's invited to, he says. That's
y ahora se me olvidó decir algo. Esta metodología de hacer un proyecto y que la comunidad sepa cuánto vale y que todos empiecen a hacer los eventos y las cosas para conseguir el presupuesto, Eso es muy tradicional en Colombia y yo creo que en las ciudades latinoamericanas. Así fue como la Iglesia Católica construyó la cantidad de iglesias que hay en los barrios, por ejemplo, de Medellín, donde llegaba un sacerdote, empezaba a crear sus rituales y las amas de casa y las doñas o las mamás empezaban a hacer empanaditas, empezaban a hacer festivales y empezaban a recoger plata entre todas y terminaban haciendo unas catedrales con este sentido, ¿cierto? Entonces lo que nosotros hacemos es, ya no construimos pues catedrales y eso, sino que construimos el bien común a partir del todos ponen.
So, you know, if you have a kind of an intimate history of Colombia, of the violence in Colombia and of the development of local neighborhoods, you know, you have this huge presence that happens around the time of the violences of kind of priests, kind of rogue priests who go off into neighborhoods and set up little chapels. Effectively, they're kind of community organizers as much as priests, kind of hippie priests, I guess. And then through these kind of efforts during the conflicts and the violence of the mid to late 20th century, you start to get coinvites that work around the construction of a single space, right? The idea that it's not just people helping each other out to build their own houses, but something collective. And then this is gendered in a very particular way. So particularly women were the strongest and most active in organizing these parties and cooking for the parties, and then take on, when the priests leave, assume the leadership role that a small kind of rogue priest might have had. So, and then that is very much the network that Panris plugs into when he works.
There's a question by Marco Fiorino. I tried to translate it in Spanish. I'm gonna do my best. I'll read it in English first. It says, thank you so much for the great presentation, Panris and Nick. In Panris's presentation, the slide that showed the dinámicas and elementos reminded me of the Harawayan concept of making kins, connecting to every form of life at different scales. Creating these connections seems to undermine a strong bond that the inhabitants of these communities must already have with their land. In a decolonizing context, especially in the West, where creating these connections to land and other beings is increasingly difficult, what can we learn from the communities that we're working with? Thank you. En español, yo lo traduciría como Panris y Nick, muchas gracias por la maravillosa presentación. En la presentación de Panris, la diapositiva que mostraba dinámicas y elementos me recordaron al concepto harawayano de crear relaciones y conexiones entre la gente. Conexiones de muchas formas en distintas escalas. Generar estas conexiones parecería afectar una conexión que ya existe entre los habitantes y las comunidades y con la tierra. En un contexto de descolonización, especialmente en el oeste, donde hoy en día es difícil crear estas conexiones con otras personas y con la tierra, ¿qué nos puedes o qué has podido aprender de las comunidades con las que tú estás trabajando?
Hay un ejercicio que es fundamental y es aprender a escuchar. Y en la medida que uno aprende a escuchar, pues también aprende a ceder. Y hay veces el acto creativo como más oportuno es ceder. Cuando una comunidad y cuando un colectivo pues no está lo suficientemente organizado para desarrollar un proyecto arquitectónico, pues no se debe forzar. Y casi que hay veces que nosotros nos invitan y nosotros decimos como no, pues es que todavía no está, o sea, todavía no hay la suficiente energía colectiva para que lo hagamos. Y esto más bien va a traer cosas críticas. Por ejemplo, el Faro es un proceso que lleva más o menos 5 años para construir un edificio de 100 metros cuadrados. Entonces es de paciencia, es de dejar ser las cosas y de ponerse también como de una manera más empática y humilde ante el ejercicio creativo, ¿cierto? Es como estar tranquilo.
I can translate if you like, Matt.
I took notes, but you can give it a try if you want.
I may get it wrong. So, you know, I guess it's a challenging question, but I think the answer, I think Fanny started with the answer, you know, the overwhelming importance, and it's so easy to underestimate, is to learn to listen and to learn to cede. So to not to try to control and to not try to speak, but to listen. And that's underestimated as a challenge, right? So how does one shape a practice around listening and around ceding, around seceding or give, or kind of allowing for others to take control? And that is the constant dance of working with, you know, not maybe not always entirely understanding, but trying to understand and allowing the space for local forms of practice to emerge. So it gives the example of the first project or the first in Faro, 100 square meter project. It's been 5 years, right? So just so you know, it totally goes against the logics of development, which involves speed and extraction of resources and changing land values, and it's just extremely slow and patient process that allows for listening and for constant modes of ceding, meaning like seceding, like giving way.
Hay veces que lo que el territorio necesita son agentes que escuchen, comunidades que solo necesitan que las escuchen para empezar a valorar lo que ellos ya son, porque de repente ya no se valora, ¿cierto? O sea, ya no encuentran valor en la cotidianidad y en el mundo en el que vivimos. Entonces, solo el hecho de escuchar y de escuchar atentamente para empezar a reconocer las cosas que hay, pues casi que las soluciones están ahí, ¿sí? Entonces, creo que es más convicción que ansiedad de proponer cosas nuevas, es convicción como de vivir bien, ¿cierto? Pues como de pasar bueno en todos los ámbitos de lo que es hacer la vida.
I think that a core concept is value and valorization. And these are people who've experienced, who've constantly been told that where they live is not valued by institutions and dominant structures. And yet, of course, there are value systems that are very, very present and very, very important. And so, you know, listening and conceding to that value system is, which one might never actually grasp entirely, is at the heart of the practice. And then you said some other stuff I missed. Mal, do you remember?
Well, there I sense some parallels with the social unrest that's happening in Colombia at the moment. He mentioned that often the solutions are very present and are really there, but there's really an underestimation of the potential of listening.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and the sort of idea of dignity and claiming that through listening is what's really powerful, both at the scale of a firm, but also at the scale of societies in general, and just being hopeful of he commented on the human need to like enjoy our life in general.
So,
pasar bueno, and
I pick up on that because, yeah, I think it comes out of some of our conversations, you know, and just to kind of ad lib on top of it, you know, our tendency is so often to problematize parts of the city, and actually our disciplines as architects, as urbanists, as scholars are invested in the idea at the end of the day, there's a problem that needs to be fixed so often, right? So in some way, we're all kind of complicit, even as we try to understand in problematizing someone's life that actually is often, if you just let them get on with it and give the support and infrastructure and foundation and kind of, you know, foundational kind of goods that are needed to get that to organize a valued and meaningful life, that it will resolve itself in a sense, right? So, you know, it's not about problematizing constantly and somehow realizing that our professions as architects and planners and scholars relies on, you know, the sector of informality as something that has to be, you know, It's about protecting it in a way from other forces that are constantly trying to fix it, I suppose, right? By listening.
Yeah, I think it's the best final note, to conclude this conversation and in a way, the year as a whole, the whole notion of value and what do we see as valuable and what do we support as architects, as planners, and as urbanists. I don't think there are any more questions. And I think, yes, it's time to conclude. So thank you so much, Panris, and also Nick, for this fascinating talk. And thank you all for joining us this evening, at least in the UK. It's a lovely day in this part of the UK. This is our last event for this academic year. We started and unfolded with Colombia, with a talk by Felipe Hernandez, then explored many other contexts of decolonizing architecture, and finishing with Colombia today, moving from a very academic discourse to a discourse which is academic, but also very much based in practice. And this is what we are intending to continue to do. So we will continue to unfold in the next academic year. And please stay tuned. You will all be invited to these events. And even if it will happen in person, and I'm optimistic here, it will also happen online, because I think we also managed to build this kind of community beyond this particular institution that is interested in all of these topics. Have a great summer. If you are in an area where you can socialize, go to lots of parties. It's important and valuable. And see you all again in October. So thank you very much again, Panris.
Muchísimas gracias, Panris.
Gracias.
Ojalá nos veamos en Cambridge cuando vengas.
Nos vemos.
Gracias, Panris. Pronto en Cambridge, después del COVID.
Thank you.
Bueno, pues.
Yeah, let us know when we will come and meet you in person.
And we'll have a coinvite in the courtyard of the department.
Los espero. Pueden venir.
Bueno, pues. Buen día. Bye.
Bye.
No, thank you. Thank you, Mom.
Thank you, Nick.
Thanks for having me.